Salut! Salut, so welcome to this live once again. Feel free to ask me any questions you want. Si vous avez des questions, n'hésitez pas à me les poser. So ask me your questions, anything really. It doesn't really matter, whatever your level. And by the way, when you are asking me a question, it's good to give me your level. In brackets as well next to it, so then I know how to answer it. I won't give the same answer if you are a beginner than if you are advanced, for instance. So sometimes even advanced people may have problem with some concepts like grammar concepts or whatever it could be, and I can give a basic, I would say, answer to beginners because there's no need to confuse people. Sometimes it's better to just say something which is partially correct. But then, better for a beginner point of view, then they know, they'll understand, they will work out with this later on, and eventually realize that what they knew was partially correct, rather than giving the whole thing, the whole answer, and at the end of the day, you have more confused people. I'm not saying that I will answer something incorrect. But I'm just saying that I sometimes prefer to give a partial answer, just briefly answering something rather than give the whole explanation that may confuse you more than anything else. So the key for me is to explain you something. It's not just to do a lecture on French, right? So I just would like to be sure that if you are if the sound and the picture, I mean the video is okay, please let me know in the chat. Then I know that you can hear me properly and you can see me properly as well. Salut Ali. So for those of you who are here, do you have any questions or anything that you want me to answer? I hear you fine. Okay, cool. That's good to know. So, what do you want to talk about? I was thinking. Salut, tu vas bien? Salut Denzim, ça va? Ça va, ça va. Ça va, ça va bien, ça va bien. Bonjour, bonjour Philippe. So, just. Hi there. Hi Citra. So, just to. Let people, to allow people to come slowly onto the chat. I was thinking, I wanted to come back on pronominal verbs, if you want. And then, of course, if you got questions, as usual, ask me and I'll try to answer them. But I thought today it may be good if I could just talk a bit about pronominal verbs. Okay. I'll try to explain them. And depending on your level, you may able to understand more, but hopefully that will help you. That will help you. So if I start, and then again, feel free to ask me questions. It's just for me a way to start the live rather than just waiting for your questions. Just I start the live like this, and then little by little you can ask me questions. So I wanted to talk about the pronominal verbs. Today. So a pronominal verb in French, c'est un verbe pronominal. Okay, Denzel, I do this after my explanation. That's a good idea. So pronominal verb, it's a verb pronominal in French. They are wrongly called in English reflexive verbs. Okay, you're gonna understand why I don't like to call them reflexive verb, but instead you have to call them pronominal verb. So, un verbe pronominal, for instance, is the usual example is se laver. Okay, so this is the infinitive of the verb se laver. It's a pronominal verb because we have here a pronoun. Okay, so in English you will translate that as to wash oneself. Okay, so if you conjugate this. Then you have je me lave, tu te laves, il se lave. Okay, then we have nous, nous lavons, vous, vous lavez, and il se love. Okay, so this is the conjugation of a pronominal verb, which is here se laver, to wash oneself. So I, je me lave, I wash myself. Tu te laves, you wash yourself. Il se lave, he wash himself. Nous nous lavons, we wash ourselves. Vous vous lavez, you wash yourselves. And ils se lavent, they wash themselves. Okay, so in this context, the verb se laver, it is reflexive. Reflexive, that means that the subject does an action on himself or herself. Okay, so it's like a reflection of a mirror. Okay, so this idea of reflexivity. So je washes himself. Okay, so je me lave means I wash myself. So I does the action and myself receive the action. So the one that receives the action and the one that does the action are in fact the same person. So that's why we call this form of a pronominal verb reflexive. Okay, same with tu te laves, you wash yourself. So you does the action and yourself receives the action. So this is a particularity of those pronominal verbs is in the reflexive form is that the action is done on yourself. Okay, you do the action on yourself. Okay, now if I can give you another example of another pronominal verb, such as for instance, se téléphoner. Se téléphoner and se téléphoner, that means to call oneself. But it doesn't work if I say, for instance, nous, nous téléphonons. If I write that, then this doesn't mean, I mean, it could, but if you think about it, we call ourselves Sounds a bit bizarre. Like we phone ourselves. Nobody really phone himself or herself, right? So I don't call myself unless my phone is. I can't find my phone, and I grab the phone of someone and I call myself. Okay. But most of the time, what that means is we call each other. And here it's not reflexive, it's what we call reciprocal. So the idea of reciprocity. So someone does an action on someone else, and that same and the other person does exactly the same action to the first person. So it's the idea of reciprocity. Okay? So here that's what we mean, but when we say nous nous téléphonons, it means we call each other. If you take, for instance, the verb s'écrire, to write, in the pronominal form, then it would be the same here. Nous nous écrivons. If you're saying nous nous écrivons, it either means in a reflexive form, rewrite to ourselves, which sounds a bit bizarre, like you write to yourself, okay? But more likely, it is accepted in a reciprocal form, which is rewrite to each other. In other terms, in French, without context, you don't know if we are having a reflexive form or reciprocal form. The context helps you. What I'm saying, nous nous lavons. In fact, you don't know if it is if we are talking about we wash ourselves, so I wash myself and you wash yourself, or we wash each other. We are together in the same shower and we wash each other. So the context helps you to understand. Most of the time, the meaning of the verb helps you to understand as well. Like téléphoner is a bit more obvious that you're gonna call each other rather than we're gonna call ourselves. But that's why when we have this form of verbs, I don't call them reflexive verbs because, as you can see here, there's nothing about reflexive. He is reciprocal. So you have to be careful how you name things. These are pronominal forms. In French, we call them les verbes pronominaux because they accept another pronoun before. We can have the verb laver, which means to wash, and se laver, to wash oneself. Okay? So here is a pronominal form. We have several things about pronominal form. We have reflexive form, a reflexive aspect, I would say. We have a reciprocal aspect when we do things on each other. Then there are other pronominal verbs which are pronominal, and that's it. There's no really logic out of it. It's just they can't be in a non-pronominal form, so they have to be pronominal. And if you look at a logical meaning, there's none. It's just they are pronominal, and that's it. And sometimes as well, we have what we call a passive voice out of this pronominal form. But I would like it to be clear because most of the time, my students, it's not so clear what a pronominal form, a pronominal verb is. And pronominal verbs, they are using être as an auxiliary when you conjugate them in the past. So if you want the passé composé, then you would have to have être. Je me suis lavé. I washed myself. So here you have to have suis. Okay? So this is the idea of pronominal form. If you want me to explain a bit more in details for some of you who are a bit or a bit more advanced, let me know in the comments and I can continue my explanation. If you got any questions about this pronominal form, please feel free to ask me. Okay, if it's clear and you think like you're fine according to your level that was enough, fine. Let's move on. Let's stay there. But if you want me to explain a bit more in detail, especially the passive voice out of this pronominal form, feel free to let me know. Let me know in the on the in the chat, and I will explain you in more details. How does dit fit into that? How does dit fit into that? What do you mean by dit? Se dire? Are you talking about se dire? So the verb dire in the pronominal form, which is se dire, to tell one another. Because se dire exists, yeah? Dire means to say or to tell, and se dire means to tell each other. So nous disons, whatever, des insultes, we're insulting each other, we are saying to each other insults. Okay? He said, I said. Okay, here, when you say he said, I said, you are using the verb dire in a past. In French, it would be, let's say, passé composé. So therefore, it would be dire. That would become in passé composé, j'ai dit. I said. This is not pronominal at all. I say, or I said something. Okay, so that this is not pronominal. Now, if you got the verb se dire, would be in English to tell one another, then I can say, nous sommes dit, blah, blah, blah. We told each other, we said to each other something. Yeah, and here you understand that here is être, because it's the pronominal form. Here is avoir, because it's a normal verb that accepts avoir as an auxiliary in the passé composé. What if you're talking to each other? Talking to each other, it would be se parler. Se parler. Se parler would be to talk to each other. To speak to each other. So for instance, if I say on se parle, means we're talking, so we're not. For instance, I don't know, let's say I argued with someone, and then I didn't want to talk to that person anymore. And then now, little by little, you understand, that's okay. At the end of the day, it was no big deal. Let's talk to each other again. Then I can say, on se parle. Yeah. So, avec Marie, on se parle. With Marie, we talk again. We talk to each other. Yeah. So that would be, on se parle. Okay. Now, if you want to say, to talk to, talking to each other, is on se parler. Or then it would be just a normal verb, discuter, to chat. So on discute, we chat. Yeah. What if okay, as in action or talking to yourself, on dit. If you're saying on dit, that means we say. Present tense of the verb dire. So we say or one says. Okay. If I talk to myself, it would be se parler once again. Je me parle. I speak to myself. Yeah. Je me parle. I speak to myself. Or then you would say, je parle tout seul. I speak alone. Yeah. Is that okay? The other? Are you okay with that? And then Denzel, we can go on to your, talk about your idea about coffee and things like that. On leur dit. On leur dit is different. On leur dit is we tell them. This is not pronominal. This is a normal verb, dire, used with an indirect pronoun. Okay, so here is on leur dit, we tell them. So the person that does the action, we, is not the same as receiving the action, them. So we have two group of people. We have we and we have them. And you have an action between those two groups, which is different than while I'm talking here, when the action is done in the same group or to the same person. Nous nous disons. Ouais, nous nous disons. Nous nous disons tous. We tell. Nous nous disons tout, maybe, I think you want to say, with T-O-U-T. We tell to each other everything. So we say to each other everything as there's no secret between us. We're saying everything to each other. So that would be two, yeah, T-O-U-T. Nous nous disons tout. Yeah, and that's accepted and that's said. Nous nous disons tout means we say everything to each other. So let's not hide anything. Let's be honest. Nous nous disons tout. Have we talked about the difference between tout, tous and tout? Maybe not, actually. And I know that this is a problem. They confuse me. Okay, I can answer that, Esther. I can answer this question. And then again, I come back on to this. Are you okay with that? I'm going to remove this. Okay. So, tout. So we have tout, tout, and tout. Do I have still inks in this? I'm pretty sure there's no ink anymore. So first of all, we have this one. Tout, tout, tout. So this one is not pronounced, yeah? For now. Here, this list, They are adjectives. In other terms, they're going with a noun. They're not used on their own. So for instance, I would say tout le monde. Literally means all the world. In English, it would be everybody. Okay, tout le monde. Tout le monde est ici. Everybody is here. Okay. Then we have tout, tous les jours. Every day. Tous les jours, je vais à l'école, whatever. So every day, I'm going to school. I go to school, sorry. So tous les jours, every day, all the day. Then we have toute for feminine things. So toute la journée, the whole day long. Toute la journée, je travaille. So I'm working all the day. Ouais. And then toute, feminine plural, toutes les femmes. Alors là, sont belles. Let's be nice. Okay, so every woman is nice. Literally, all women are nice or beautiful. Okay, so here is singulier masculin. Here is pluriel masculin. Here is singulier féminin. And here is pluriel féminin. Okay. So tout le monde. Here le monde is masculin singulier. Hein? Tous les jours. You don't pronounce the S here. This is pluriel masculin pluriel. Toute la journée. You do pronounce the T here because you got E at the end. So toute. Here you don't pronounce it. Hein? Toute la journée. That will be feminine. Singular, féminin singulier. And toutes, don't pronounce the S, les femmes. Here you have feminine plural. So therefore you got toutes. And that would mean all or every in English, yeah? So all the world, literally, so everybody. Tous les jours, all days, so literally every day. Then toute la journée, the whole day long, okay? So all the day. And then toutes les femmes, every woman. So here, all ladies. Okay, so this is an adjective. Okay? Now, you can have these words on their own as well, and they will be pronouns. So in other terms, they can be subject of your verb. Example, tout est arrivé. If I say tout est arrivé, that means everything has arrived. Everything has arrived. So that is now a subject. What has arrived? Everything. So here's one word. That's not an adjective, this is a pronoun. It looks the same word, but it's not grammatically the same word. This was an adjective, so therefore it was with a noun afterwards. This one can be used on its own. Tout est arrivé. Okay? For instance, everything that we ordered. Okay? All the items. Tout est arrivé. Everything has arrived. Then, I can have tous sont venus. Tous sont venus. And here you do pronounce the S. That means all of them came. All of them. Of course, because this is a pronoun, you know the rule of pronouns is that we need to have a context before. If I just say that on its own, it doesn't mean much. All came. All who. Yeah. Now if I say tous les étudiants sont venus, all students came, all of them came, all came, then you know what I mean. So tous here will mean all of them or all came. Here you do pronounce the S, here you didn't pronounce the S. This is an adjective, this is a pronoun. And it would be the same for tout and tout. Actually, we don't have really tout on its own, but we have tout, this one here, which is the same as this one, but feminine plural. So toutes sont venues, all of them, as all of these girls, all the girls, all of them are beautiful. So instead of writing the whole thing here, I can just write toutes, and that would be a pronoun. I hope it is clearer. If not, feel free to ask me again some more questions. Could you please explain the difference between regarder and voir with example, please, thank you. What word arriver seems to have so many contexts. Well, arriver, yeah, arriver means to arrive here. But it means to happen as well, to occur. So I'll be careful. Ellen, could you explain the difference between regarder and voir? Yeah, it's pretty easy. You will see, Ellen, because in fact, it's the idea of active passive. Regarder means to actively look for something. Voir is just you open your eyes and you see things. So there's the difference between to watch and to look. To watch and to see, sorry. Okay? So when I use regarder, it means that I'm actively looking for something. Je regarde, yeah? So for instance, je regarde un film, okay? You're actively looking at it. Voir is just to have eyes open and you have pictures coming at you. That is voir. So it's more passive, you know what I mean? Regarder is more active. It's exactly the same difference between écouter et entendre. Okay? Entendre means to hear. Écouter means to listen. Écouter is actif, j'écoute. Entendre is just I hear. So I hear noise. Okay? J'entends un bruit. So there are noise that comes into my ear. Okay? So it's just I'm not actively listening to it. It's just it comes. Okay? So I can hear noise here. My computer makes a lot of noise. I can hear it. Yeah? J'entends. Mais j'écoute pas particulièrement. J'écoute de la musique, for instance. I listen to music. Because here, I'm actively concentrating on what I'm listening. It's not just sound that comes to my mind. It's actually, I'm actively listening and I'm on purpose listening to something specific. So écoute, when I say écoute-moi, it means listen to me. Because I want you to be actively listening to me, not to something else around you. Me. Okay, that would be écoute-moi. Now, when I asked you before, est-ce que vous pouvez m'entendre? Can you hear me? It's just, is the sound okay? Is the sound coming at your ear without you making too much of an effort? Is that something more passive? So the difference between regarder and voir. Regarder means to watch, to look, so it will be active. Voir, it will just be to see, okay? And entendre, écouter, same idea. Entendre, to hear, passive. Écouter, more active. Now, of course, sometimes we're a bit more loose, if you know what I'm saying, especially when we talk about film. We can say, je regarde un film, or you could say, more in the past, for instance, j'ai vu un film, I saw a movie, rather than j'ai regardé un film. You could just say, I saw a movie. So here you see, same in English, it's a bit loose, but most of the time I would say it works when you're talking about to watch versus to see. Thank you, that's clear. Does the French language have any phrasal verbs? We don't have phrasal verbs as such, like in English. We don't have the same. What we have instead, we have preposition after verbs, okay, which are fixed, like in English. For instance, we're saying donner quelque chose à quelqu'un, so it's to give something to someone, okay. So we have fixed preposition here afterwards. But we don't have the idea of phrasal verbs like in English. For instance, to give, then it becomes to give up, to give out, to give away, to give in, things like that. We don't have that in French. What we have is we have the pronominal form, as I just explained before. That will sometimes change the meaning of the verb. Like a phrasal verb will have his meaning changed depending on what preposition comes after. It's not, there's a difference between to give and to give out, or to give in and to give away, or to give up. But it's the same in French with some verbs. Some verbs will have their meaning altered, slightly changed, if they are in a pronominal form. For instance, attendre means to wait. S'attendre à means to expect. You can see the meaning is very, very almost the same. When I expect you to do something, in fact, I was waiting for you to do something. But it's slightly different. There's a difference between to wait and to expect. So it's the same as attendre, s'attendre. So that's how it works in French. Not really with preposition afterwards, like phrasal verbs, but more like, for instance, in other things. For instance, as I said, the pronominal form will change the meaning. Is that okay with tous, tous, tous? Are you guys okay with that? I should make a video on that actually, because I know that this is a bit of a problem. Especially when do you pronounce the S, when you don't? Yeah. So here you don't pronounce the S tous les jours. You don't pronounce the S because it's an adjective. Here you do pronounce the S because it's a pronoun. Tous sont venus. Okay, that can be substituted by les garçons sont venus. Okay? Guys came, boys came. So you can substitute this. You can't substitute that. Slightly okay with it. Okay. What tense of the verb is the least used in French? What tense? Ouais, merci. Good. Tense of the verb that is not used, passé simple, very not used anymore, except in literature, and even there's not a lot of writers now that are using passé simple. I mean, they are, but it's not. So it's not the tense that we use every day. Same for passé antérieur, which is the past of that tense. Then we have all the subjunctives. We're using only two subjunctives, which are subjunctive présent, subjunctive passé. We have two other tenses in the subjunctive, which are subjunctive imparfait, subjunctive plus que parfait, that is not used at all. So they're not used at all. So these will be the four tenses that I strongly, how do you say, I strongly advise you not to learn. Yeah, merci. A video will be great, but I'm a beginner. Okay. Okay, no problem, merci. What was it? It was Denzel, I think you asked me for something like about the coffee. What was it? It's grabbing coffee. Can you talk through a coffee shop scenario, ordering bills, key phrases, words, slang? Okay, so you enter, that's very great. And you know what, actually, last time I was talking to my brother about the videos and the channel in general, and he said something good. I think he said that I should do videos more about like situational videos, like for instance, what would you do if you just arrived in France and beam, you want to order coffee, you want to do this, you want to do that. So rather than concentrating on grammar, I would say grammar topics or points, to do something more like situational and try to scan the sentences and something that you can expect to be answered, and something that you kind of supposed to know when you're entering a specific place. So if you talk about, so this is a very good idea. If you talk about the coffee shop, okay. Most of the time, in France, when you're going to a coffee shop, it's not like the type of like Starbucks, for instance, when you just go to the counter and you order your coffee and then they will give it to you straight away at the counter. Most of the time in France, we have what we call the terrasse, and you just sit down and then the waiter will come at you, okay? And then he will serve you the coffee. So it's not necessary, you don't have to go to the cashier, you're just gonna be served like in a normal bar. Normal for us, I would say. So, of course, you do have more and more this idea of going to the counter and waiting for and ask for coffee, then wait for the coffee to be done, to be made, and then you grab it and you go to sit down whenever you want. But most of the time in the traditional cafe in France, then you just sit down wherever you want, inside or outside, and then you don't even have to ask anything. Most of the time you just sit down. It's up to the waiter to know that you arrived, and then he will ask you. So what would you ask? You would just say un café. If you're saying un café, okay, so one coffee. Un café, without mentioning anything, you're gonna be served an espresso in France. Okay, so if you just ask un café, you don't need to say an espresso, whatever. Un café will be de facto an espresso. Straight away, for sure. If you want something a bit more specific, then you will have to ask it. But if you just say un café, the default coffee in France will be an espresso. So I would say un café. Then you could say une noisette. Une noisette, it's like it means literally a hazelnut. And we're saying that because the coffee looks like an hazelnut, but it doesn't have the taste of hazelnut. And noisette would be more like a macchiato, if you know what I mean. So it's coffee with a bit of milk. Okay, so that would be noisette. Okay, then we have cappuccino, like everywhere, cappuccino. Café crème as well, so with cream. So it's type of cappuccino as well. Then that's it, really. We're not too fancy with coffees that you can ask. I mean, of course, if you look at the menu, maybe you will find some more specific things at that bar. But otherwise, we don't have much. So I would say most of the time, people just ask for a coffee and they drink espresso, like in Italy. We drink espresso a lot in France. So you will come and you will say, un café, s'il vous plaît. Okay. And then the waiter says whatever he says. Okay, pas de problème. He comes back to the café. You say merci. Because you are a well-educated person, And then at the end, once you finish and you want to go, you could just ask the waiter or the waitress, l'addition s'il vous plaît. Okay, l'addition s'il vous plaît. And then he brings you the bill. And then sorry, I'm just having a slight problem with the live. I think it's okay. Yeah, it's okay. So you ask l'addition, s'il vous plaît. Okay. So l'addition, that means the bill. L'addition, s'il vous plaît. It gives you the bill. You pay. You leave the money on the table, so you don't have to bring him the money. Just leave it on the table. Put whatever you want. You can put a bit more if you want to leave tips. And then that's it, you leave, and it's up to the waiter or the waitress to take the money, to grab the money that you left on the table. That's it, really. There's not much really you could say. Please don't. I'm pretty sure none of you will do this, but I can still see people who kind of think it is acceptable to call the waiter garçon. Okay, this is very rude. It means boy, it's very old-fashioned. And borderline, I don't even know what to say. It's not racist because it doesn't imply anything about race, but it's kind of like calling someone your slave, basically. So if you say garçon, it's super rude. So you would just say s'il vous plaît if you want to call the just ask him or her to look at you. More likely gonna be like s'il vous plaît, can raise your hand. Appreciate the fact that the person is busy as well, so you know what it is. So if he comes next to you, you could just say s'il vous plaît, and then you could say, okay, est-ce que je peux commander? Est-ce que je peux commander? Commander means to order, okay? So to order, commander. So est-ce que je peux commander? Can I order? Est-ce que je peux commander, s'il vous plaît? Can I order, please? Yes, oui, ok, un café s'il vous plaît, blablabla. Bla, 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 bla. And then at the end, you just say, s'il vous plaît, l'addition. Ok? Then you don't even need to say l'addition, like in some places, in France, it works as well. If the waitress or the waiter looks at you, so you kind of call him or her, she looks at you, even if she's far, you can just make a small gesture with your hands, such as like a small squarey thing, for instance, and he or she will understand that you're asking for the bill. So you don't necessarily have to shout l'addition, you could just say a small rectangle like that, and that means can have the bill. So if the person most of the time is super far, you could just say you could just ask for the bill. Exactly, if you need the menu. Est-ce que je peux avoir la carte? So la carte will be the menu, okay? Est-ce que je peux avoir la carte? And then he or she gives you the menu, the drinks menu. That's it really about coffee. I'm pretty sure that's it. If you're saying keep the change we're saying la monnaie. Okay, so la monnaie is the change. Okay, la monnaie. I'm having problem with live today. I think it's fine. Are you okay with the live? Is he not? Because it tells me like the stream health is not high. So I hope you're fine. But we'll see. If you're not, just let me know. Not that there's a lot of things I can do about it anyway, but hope it's okay. So la monnaie, that would be the change. So you could say, for instance, garder la monnaie. Keep the change. Or the waiter may ask, may say, oh, okay, votre monnaie, monsieur, votre monnaie, and then he gives you some change, okay, just change, tac, votre monnaie, so your change, here we go. Okay, so la monnaie will be the change, okay? Okay? Bien, quelle est la différence entre la prononciation de jaune, jeune et juin? Okay, you get it. Jaune, jeune, juin. Jaune. Is yellow, jo, o, with a sound o, jaune. Then we have jeune, with a sound e, jeune. And then we have juin, 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 which is June, okay? So it's yellow, young, and June. Jo, o, O. C'est ce O, but it's close O, so it's not A, it's O. It's not jaune, but it's jaune. So it's close O, jaune. Then we have je, un. So it's like E, the E sound, like almost like a letter. A, B, C, D, E, E, jeune, jeune. And then we have juin, un, which is the nasal un, nasal sound, un, juin. I can't figure out. That's it. Is crème slang or an everyday word for coffee? Like, tu veux un crème, you want a coffee? I've heard that a lot. Yeah, exactly. So, un crème will be more like cappuccino-y type of coffee. I'm never ordering that, to be fair, so I'm not so sure what crème is, but I think it's more like cappuccino. So, there's a bit of foam, like milk foam on the top. Crème, and of course, a bit of milk as well, so it's like a milky coffee. So, it would be like cappuccino type of things, I think, or flat white in some places they call it. So, that would be crème, yeah. Not that we're saying un crème, because we're saying un café crème, okay? Rather, but you need to know that the word crème itself, it's feminine, it's une crème, okay? Cream, if you like, for instance, cream, whatever cream it is, it's for makeup or the cream, like the milk cream or whatever, double cream, whipped cream, stuff like that. That's une crème, okay? It's feminine. But un crème will be for un café crème. We remove café because it's obvious, so we end up with un crème. But note that the word crème usually is feminine, it's not masculine. So if you're saying un crème, it's obviously a choc café. Très bien. Hold on, guys. We had what is the most popular holiday for the French? The most popular holiday for the French is les grandes vacances, as we call them, les grandes vacances. And les grandes vacances is the summer holiday. It starts from 8th of June, yeah, late June, and he finish. That finishes early September, so we have 2 months in French. July and August are free, so that's the grandes vacances. We call that grandes vacances, the great holiday or the big holiday. Okay, and this is these are the most popular holiday for the French, I would say. Popular, it depends what you call popular, but for sure, when you're a kid, you really wait for that because hold on, it's 2 months, and just most of the time the weather is very nice, so it's very cool holidays. Then we have what we call Toussaint, All Saints. Okay, so we have 1 week, Toussaint, which is roughly November. Then we have Noël, Christmas, when we have 2 weeks. Then we have vacances de février. Février, that would be 1 week in février, February. And then we have Pâques, Easter, when we have roughly 2 weeks. And then we have les grandes vacances, this one, okay, for two weeks. Oh, 2 months, sorry. That's probably that's the school holidays, I would say. In Brazil, our word for waiter is garçon. I imagine Brazilians make this mistake frequently, not knowing it's very offensive. Yeah, I know that, Natasha. Same for the Russians as well. They kind of like learn it somewhere, somehow, a bit old-fashioned, and they think it's kind of acceptable. And when they go to Paris, they shout at the waiter, garçon, and it sounds a bit. It's always depending on how you're saying as well, to be fair, but it's not nice. I used to be a waiter when I was younger, and if someone had called me garçon, I would be a bit cross, to be fair with you. Garçon is a bit kind of like that, you know, you don't do that. So you don't shout someone, you don't. There are things that you don't do. Garçon is one of them, if you know what I'm saying. It's a bit, nah. We don't call them, there's no words, really. So you're just saying, s'il vous plaît. Please. And that's one way to ask for the attention rather than saying garçon. Really. And if you have to name them, because let's say you're talking to the boss and you have to say, oh, the waiter or the waitress told me this, blah, 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 whatever, then you're just saying le serveur, la serveuse. Okay? That's the correct. Le serveur or la serveuse, yeah? So this is the correct words, serveur, serveuse, waiter, waitress. This is acceptable. Don't say le garçon m'a dit. Okay, the waiter told me. The garçon told me that this is rude. So yeah. Okay. Can we hear and see? We can hear and see you fine. Okay, that's good. Plus que parfait. Plus que parfait. Exactly. Oui, super. Bien. Hi. I tried to read a literary paragraph and I found a few words confusing. Nous nous attendions à un article un moins bienveillant et c'est un des éreintements les plus féroces de Janine. Au milieu de tous ces œufs à la neige du feuilleton, il y a une perfide, c'est de faire notre livre un tableau poussant au mépris des lettres. I don't understand the word œuf à la neige. Here is that a dessert? What does that mean here? Yes. So that was a bit out of context. It's a bit hard to explain you the whole paragraph that you gave me. But if you understand the whole paragraph, except this œuf à la neige, then I won't explain it. If you want, I can explain a bit more. But œuf à la neige, it's white eggs that you just whisk, and then because you whisk them, then they become like what we call them snow. They become like white eggs when they are, you know, you whisk them. So that's what we call œuf à la neige. So œuf à la neige will be this kind of white eggs that you can either eat by themselves, or of course most of the time you put them in cakes. And I think here in your text it meant les œufs à la neige du feuilleton. Au milieu de tous ces œufs à la neige du feuilleton, it's a bit bizarre, without context, it's a bit hard for me to explain that, but I think what it means is like, because you whisk eggs, so it means like everything is mixed, okay? So I think that's what it meant. I don't have context, so it's a bit hard to know really precisely what it meant. But œuf à la neige is this dessert when you put all the eggs and then you whisk them, so I think that's what it meant by the fact that everything is kind of mixed and yeah, together. So I think that's the idea of œuf à la neige. So if everything is a bit scrambled, a bit blurry in a way that it's not really, because you just, it's a big whisk thing, yeah? So I think that what he meant. But again, without context, it's a bit hard to understand. The difference between faire plus verbe and laisser plus verbe. Okay, the difference between faire plus verbe and laisser plus verbe. Faire plus verbe, faire manger, for instance. If I'm saying, je fais manger les enfants. That is what we call the causative or factitive, okay? And that is that you do an action. You do an action on someone, meaning that you ask someone to do an action. For instance, je fais manger les enfants. I'm having kids. They can't really eat by themselves. They need help. So je fais manger is I make the kids to eat, literally. Okay, so I'm having, je fais réparer, okay, another example, maybe easier to translate. Je fais réparer ma voiture. I'm having my car fixed. So literally, I make someone repairing my car. Je fais réparer ma voiture. Réparer means to fix, to repair, yeah? So je fais réparer ma voiture. I'm having my car repaired. I make someone to repair my car. So I ask someone, can you repair my car? And he does that for me. So it's to have things, it's to have someone doing something for your own benefit. Okay, that's what we call causative factitive, if you are a bit more interested and you want to look at that. Again, that will be one of my videos at some point. Now, laisser faire, laisser plus verbe, laisser implies the idea of to let someone, to allow someone to do something. So here's the idea of you grant a permission to someone to do something. J'ai laissé les enfants sortir. I let the kids I let them going out. Okay, so it's the idea of to let, to allow. So laisser, laisse. So if I'm saying, for instance, laisse-moi faire, it would be let me do it, let me do. Yeah, allow me to just do freely. Okay, so that's the idea between faire and laisser. Faire implies the fact that you ask someone to do something for your own benefit. I would say it's a bit more complicated than that, but to be easy, that's what it is. And laisser is the idea of permission. So laisser is really the idea of let. So you let someone to do something. You give them the permission. Speaking of holidays, le 14 juillet is coming up. Yeah, exactly. 14 juillet is coming up. So la fête nationale, National Day, it's coming up. So it's gonna be. I'm gonna bring my my costume. I don't know if some of you, if all of you saw, but I posted a video when I'm how old am I? I'm 5. There's a video of me on the channel where I'm 5 years old, and I'm just showing a picture of me being 5 years old, and I'm wearing a costume of the revolutionist, the people who made the revolution during the French Revolution, because that was for the 200th anniversary of the French Revolution. So if you're interested in me wearing a very nice costume, have a look at my video. Bonjour, j'ai une question pour vous. If you want to say, how do you say that? Like a filler sentence when you can't think of a word, what would you say? You would say, comment est-ce qu'on dit blah 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 blah, and then you can add if it's not necessary super obvious en français. Okay, so comment est-ce qu'on dit computer en français? Okay, so literally means how one says computer in French. So comment est-ce qu'on dit computer in French? Or on dit, the answer, on dit, one says, we say, ordinateur. Ok? So comment est-ce qu'on dit? You got, of course, you got plenty of different ways of asking this question, but that's one of them. I think that's pretty good. It goes in all contexts, so it's pretty good. Comment est-ce qu'on dit? Hello, comment est-ce qu'on dit? Ah, yeah, comment dit-on? Ok, you have it already. Comment dit-on? Yeah, comment dit-on? It's ok, it's just slightly more correct. I would say it's a bit more, it's a bit poshier, it's a bit more upper French. Comment dit-on? Comment est-ce qu'on dit? Slightly more current French, less. It's not good, it's not the word, but you know what I mean? It's like there are different registers. It's like you're very, very polite and very correct and very formal. Less informal, very informal. The one here is neither formal nor informal. It's kind of in between. Yours is a bit more formal, but totally fine as well. Je veux dire. Yeah, je veux dire could work as well. Je veux dire computer en français. I want to say computer in French. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for the explanation. No problem. Salut Thomas. Salut Dina. Merci. No problem. Do you perhaps have a text or song lyrics or maybe that gets the person game? Yeah, we can do that, definitely. How does that differ from qu'est-ce que c'est? Qu'est-ce que c'est means what is it? What is it? So it's slightly different. Your question is not the same. If you're saying qu'est-ce que c'est, that is what is it? For instance, if I look at the computer, I point at the computer and I'm saying qu'est-ce que c'est? What is it? And then you may say, okay, un ordinateur. Yeah, but this is not the same as asking how would you say in French the word computer. Because qu'est-ce que c'est? If you don't point at anything, then I don't know what you're talking about. If you're just saying qu'est-ce que c'est like that out of the blue, that means what is it? What is it what? What are you talking about? Now if I show you something like the guitar and I'm saying qu'est-ce que c'est, then you would say, oh, it's a guitar. Okay, but if you don't have a guitar around you and you don't know how to say the word guitar, then you could say, comment est-ce qu'on dit guitare en français? On dit guitare. Ok, you see the difference here between your two questions? Salut! Ok, merci. Ah, pas de problème. Pas de problème. Comment dirais-je? Ouais, comment dirais-je? It's very, very formal as well, hein? Comment dirais-je? It's very formal. How would you say? How would I say? Very formal again. Comment dirais-je? No, no, I'm correct. I've got nothing... I'm not against the formal way of speaking French, but sometimes we are reproached, us French teacher, that we are teaching something a bit too formal sometimes. So I try to teach you something a bit less formal, a bit more like the 4x4, as I call it, yeah, something like all terrain. You can go in any context. I like to teach that to my students, like sentences that will be useful in any context, regardless of who you're talking to. Something neither too formal nor too informal, something correct and neutral. Comment dirais-je? I accept that. But it's less common, I would say. It's a bit more formal. But it's good. Again, I've got nothing against the formality. As long as it's correct, I'm happy. What is the meaning of c'est dire? Not c'est-à-dire. C'est dire, not c'est-à-dire. So c'est-à-dire, that is to say. C'est dire. I don't know, Soko. I don't know what you mean because of course I've got an idea, but I don't know your level. So are you sure you saw c'est dire or not? Because if your level is a bit more advanced, or if you saw c'est dire in a text or someone French said it, then I may know what that means. No, it's not I may know. I know what that means, but I'm not sure that you don't.
I'm not sure if you mean this or if you made a mistake. So you sure it's you are saying sedir, and you sure that you've seen that somewhere written or like a French person? Because that's an expression. I'm not sure if. But please tell me your level and tell me where you've seen that, and then I can, because I just want to be sure that you don't make a mistake. Because otherwise, there's no need to for me to explain something that is a bit more, a bit advanced, a bit detailed, if this is not what you meant. Can you tell any French pronunciation tricks? There's not a lot of tricks, I'm afraid. Tricks. To be fair, tricks is to listen to French people, listen to radio, listen to film, listen to music. I think that it's easier when you are when you listen to French sounds to kind of copy them. That's one trick I will give. It's always easier for me, for everybody, it's easier to kind of copy an accent when you are submerged in the language rather than if you are artificially try to pronounce something. So it would be easier for you to pronounce French, I would say, correctly if you listen to French people, to listen to music, films and stuff like that. That would be one trick. The second trick I can give, that's the problem, for instance, a lot of like school teenagers and stuff like that. They think they will be ridiculous if they speak the language and try mimicking the natural accent. Like in France, for instance, you could see like French teenagers, they think they will sound stupid if they try to speak English with a very correct English accent. Okay, so they prefer to speak like that, and they don't speak with a very strong accent. They have very strong French accent because they think, oh, if I speak English using an English accent, I will sound very stupid. So I prefer to say the word as a French person. But in fact, that sounds very stupid. You realize when they're coming to England and they speak like that, then people, you know, laugh at them because the accent is terrible. So that's the thing. Sometimes some of my students, they are scared a bit to speak French with a French accent or try to mimic. And of course, an exaggeration, you don't know really at first. So you're trying to exaggerate, you try to mimic, and it's fine. Don't be afraid of the idea. Most of the time, we're too afraid of the consequences. We're saying, oh, I'm going to look ridiculous and stuff. But no, I mean, no one's ridiculous for trying something and trying their best. And that's why kids are said to be better at languages. Most of all, is because kids, they don't care about the consequences. They will just mimic. They will just say things the way they hear them. They won't say, oh my God, if I say that like this, then I'm going to look stupid. So that would be my tricks for a pronunciation, really. And of course, the trick, as ever, it's to practice. More, practice, repetition, listening to videos, practice. That would be the key for me. I've heard that it's rude to say bonjour to someone you've already seen that day because they think you forgot you saw them. Is that true? Or, well, yeah, I mean, rude is maybe a harsh word, but yeah, I mean, if I see you this morning, you say bonjour, and then you come back this afternoon and you say bonjour again, I'm gonna be a bit like, is she stupid or is she amnesiac, or is she kind of like, oh, she didn't remember me? So I think it's a bit everywhere, isn't it? I mean, if I'm pretty sure in England, if you say hello to someone and you meet that person 10 hours after and you say hello again, it sounds a bit, yeah. So it's not necessarily rude, but yeah, I would say it's not, yeah, I would say, yeah. C'est-à-dire l'importance accordée aux travaux de ladite AG qui se sont déroulés dans un climat serein où les présents ont exprimé leur point de vue de... C'est dire l'importance. Ah, yeah, ok. Ah, yeah, so cool. You are the one who sent me the big paragraph. Ok, so now, yeah, your level is good, so I can answer. So definitely, you haven't made a mistake. Ok, so this is what I meant by that. So in your example, it's exactly what I thought it was. C'est dire l'importance, that means... what can I say? It's like an euphemism. You understand this word, euphemism? An euphemism is when you are saying that what you're saying, it doesn't match the importance of what happens. That's an euphemism, okay? So when you're saying c'est dire, you're in fact implying the fact that, how can I translate it in English? C'est dire l'importance accordée aux travaux.
yeah, you want to demonstrate, c'est peu dire. This is not enough to say that. In the idea of like me saying it is not even enough. So c'est dire l'importance. Yeah. Oh my God, it's a bit hard to explain. I've got it here, but I don't know how to say it properly in English. I don't understand the usage of c'est dire here. Yeah, I understand the idea of you having a bit of trouble here. I struggled to translate it. C'est dire l'importance accordée aux travaux. I tried to find another example that would be easier to translate. C'est dire. Yeah, it's the idea that what you're saying doesn't match what happens. So here when you're saying c'est dire l'importance, it is to say the importance allowed to the works of the said general assembly, blah 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 blah. So yeah. So c'est dire l'importance accordée. That's to say the importance. But with a bit of an idea of sometimes, maybe not necessarily here, but sometimes with the idea of euphemism. So it is not enough to say that, if you know what I mean. So it's really, you really want to show. Yeah, I try to find a better example and I come back into it. I have a tip for practicing pronunciation. Grab a piece of audio in French, listen to it, try to mimic the accent by recording yourself and compare the original and yours. It's exactly right, Natasha. To answer your, Meza as well, to answer your question, you know that in one of my videos, I've made a review on an app called Mozalingua, and you can follow this video, there's a link afterwards as well, and you can download through my link. Mozalingua has a beautiful kind of listen and repeat feature, so they ask you to repeat what they pronounce for you. You just repeat, you can record yourself, and then you can match the recording. So if you look at this app that I've reviewed, check my channel, check for the app called Mozalingua, and if you want to download the app, please do it through my link, as you will support the channel as well. But again, I'm not, I think it's a very good app for that as well, because it does have this feature of matching. So have a look at this as well, it may help you. One last question, because I can't find a good translation anywhere. How would you translate working out or exercise? Est-ce que c'est juste entraîner, faire les exercices, faire du sport? So, faire du sport, that would be to do sport in general. Faire des exercices, to do exercises, without context, it's a bit hard to know what exercises you're talking about. Could be grammar exercises, as it could be physical exercises, but faire des exercices could be okay as well. And then, entraîner means to train. S'entraîner means to train oneself. Again, we fall on the pronominal form. S'entraîner will mean to practice or to train. If you just want to say working out or exercise, then yeah, faire des exercices, faire de l'exercice physique. And then you could say, je vais à la salle. Je vais à la salle, meaning in English, I'm going to the gym. Je vais à la salle, meaning la salle de musculation, so the workout. So if you're saying je vais à la salle, that means you're going to a fitness center to work out. Otherwise, yeah, je fais du sport in general. If in English you would say, oh, he does a lot of exercise, he, you know, does a lot of working out, I don't know, then you would say il fait du sport, yeah. I think that's what it is. Another example. C'est un bon pâtissier, il a travaillé chez Loco pendant 10 ans, c'est dire. Exactly, that's what I meant, Loco. Soko, sorry. Okay, that's exactly what I meant. Okay, good example here. He is a good pâtissier maker, he's a good of pâtisserie maker. He has worked chez Le Nôtre, which is a very, very good pâtisserie house, yeah. Pendant 10 ans, c'est dire. So, he worked there for 10 years. That's to say the least. Do you understand that the idea in English, that's to say the least? That shows. So what I'm saying is good. It's not good. Good is good because he worked in Le Nôtre for 10 years. So that shows it. So you understand what I say? An euphemism is the idea of like, you can't even understand. Like, it doesn't match even, you know? Like, yeah, that's to say. That's to say. That's to show. That shows as an example, if you know what I mean. So that's the idea of like, to say the least. You know, he worked for Le Nôtre for 10 years, so, you know, so then I can say he's a good pâtissier, hence the c'est dire, Yeah, I can say it. I say it. I say it's a good pâtissier because look, he worked for 10. So that's the idea of c'est dire. It's the idea of to say the least. Or one can say, we can say, I dare to say he's a good pâtissier. That's the idea of c'est dire. Yeah, that shows. If that's an example. That's the idea of c'est dire. It's exactly what I meant here. I'm a truly beginner, so I don't know what's the difference between G and G. Could you please let me know, Mr. Thomas? Okay, so first, G and G, you have to be careful because in English, G is in French. I'm gonna write it down. In English, this letter is G, and this letter is J. In French, it's the other way around. That is G and that is J. Okay? One way to remember the French way is that letter is called I. So this one is called J. If you look at them, they have dots on the top. So this one looks like an E. So if this one is pronounced I, this one must be pronounced J. Okay? That is J. J, J, first of all. Then they work pretty much in the same way. But the J we always have a soft sound. What I mean by soft is J, this sound, J, J. Okay? So even if you put an A, it will be jaune. So this is J sound. Okay? If you put an E, it will be jeune. Okay? So we still have the J sound. If you put a U, it will be jus, such as Jura, which is a famous region in France, Jura. So the J will always have a J sound. Okay, a soft sound. Okay, J. J, on the other hand, doesn't have always a soft sound. It can have a hard sound, which is G. So this letter can have two sounds, which are J or G. So for instance, if you say, give you an example. I don't have a lot of example in my mind, so it's gonna be a rubbish one, but whatever. If I give you this example here, jeûner, ce flower, but it doesn't matter where. Jeûner, this is soft sound. Jeûner, by the way, it's not just jeûner. Jeûner, that's soft sound, okay? Jeûner. So this sound here is soft. Je. This sound is soft, like giraffe, giraffe. That's soft as well, J. Okay? But that is not soft, that will be ga. Okay? That is not soft, that will be go. And that is not soft, it will be gu. Okay? So if I want to make this sound hard, then I will add a U. So this one will become gi. So you don't pronounce the U, but it makes this letter having a hard sound. So instead of J, it becomes G. Instead of je, it becomes G. Yeah. So to make it hard, you put a U. To make it soft, you put a E. So if I add an E here, then it will be je. If I put a E here, then it will be jo. That doesn't exist in French anyway, but the principle is there. Okay, so if you add an E, then you will soften this letter. That's the massive difference between those two letters. This one has two sounds, soft and hard. This one has only one sound, which is soft. That's the big rule. You may find one word who has an exception. Which is an exception? I don't know. I don't have all French words in my mind, but I'm pretty sure that rules applies for 99.9% of the words. Yeah, so you're fine with that, I would say. Okay. Practice like this almost every day for a few weeks and compare your first audio to the last audio recorded, you'll improve a lot. Yeah, exactly, Natasha. That was a very good piece of advice. I've seen people say faire du sport, implying that they were training at the gym. Yeah, exactly. Faire du sport is very, how do you call it? Usual. It's very, doesn't mean much. Faire du sport, it means to exercise, to do some physical activities. That's what it is. So faire du sport could mean anything, really. To do sports, as you go to the gym, for us, it's faire du sport. Faire du sport doesn't necessarily mean like sport, like collective sports or things like that. Could be just to, it's to do a physical activity, faire du sport. So it's exactly that, yeah. Amazing. I saw in some YouTube channels that simple passive verb two in un is not used in French. We use l'imparfait and passé composé. Is it true or can you give example? I saw in some YouTube channels that simple passive verb two in un. I'm not sure about your question here, Maïsa. I saw in some YouTube channel, okay, that simple passé verb, simple passé, what is, what, passé simple, you mean? Or I don't understand the simple passé verb, to in en. What is a verb to in en? It's not used in French, we use l'imparfait and passé composé. If you're talking about passé simple, the tense called passé simple, then you're right, it's not used. Most of the time, we're using imparfait ou passé composé. Okay? So we don't use passé simple, if that is your question. So the simple past, the passé simple, or the historic past, some people call it as well, passé historique, is not used except when you're writing, and even if, when you're not writing, like if you're writing literature, then you may use it, otherwise, it's not used. So can we say that in these sentences we can delete cedir without changing the main meaning of the sentence? If so, what's the point of using the expression? Well, I mean, it's not you can remove it. It's not I can remove it. Cedir implies the fact that implies the fact that what you're saying is true, because you're saying il est bon pâtissier, il a travaillé chez le nôtre pendant 10 ans, cedir. So he's a good pâtissier, mais he's a good pâtisserie maker. He worked in Le Nôtre for 10 years. Yeah. He worked in Le Nôtre for 10 years. That shows. That shows. Yeah. That shows that what I'm saying is right. That shows, I would say, in English. Maybe that's what would be the translation, actually. That shows. You know? So it's the idea of like, what I'm saying is true. I reinforce what I'm saying by saying, well, I don't know what you want as an example if what I'm giving you is not good enough. I mean, the guy is working for 10 years in Le Nôtre, which is one of the best pâtisserie house in all France. He, therefore, is a good pâtissier. What do you want me to give you as an example? Okay, so that's to say. That's the idea of that's to say, c'est dire. Yeah, what do you want me to give you as an example? The guy worked for 10 years. Yeah, I can't give you more. There's no more than that, right? So that's the idea of c'est dire. Yes, yeah, so it's like, oh, come on, man. You see what I mean? So it's the idea of really reinforce what you're saying. Well, you can't argue with that. Yeah, that shows that shows that you can't argue with this. That's the idea of saying. That's the idea of like there's not even an argument here, man. You can't argue that. That shows. That's to say something. It's the idea of to say something. You say something when you're saying this. So it's the idea of you kind of reinforce with what you're saying here. You reinforce your argument. You reinforce what you're saying. I meant simple past in English. Yeah, so simple past means perfect. Yeah, the perfect. Well, the perfect in English will be either translated with, I mean, they will be translated by passé composé or imparfait. That would be the two main, not passé simple. So, I mean, they can, but again, skip the passé simple. We're talking about passé composé and imparfait. If we have a verb in English that is conjugated in perfect, then in French it would be passé composé or imparfait. Exactly, and then you need to know what you use according to the situation, to the context, and you have to know what rule applies. Can you tell me the difference between this alphabet A and all the other alphabet which have the line on top of it? So the difference between these letters, you mean letters, yeah? Alphabet is the whole list of letters. This what you just showed me. These are letters. So be careful. It's not alphabet. C'est une lettre. Une lettre. So this is A, this is E, and this is E most of the time. Okay, so this is A, open, this is E, close. Okay, so for instance, here we have the word, I don't know, chèvre, which is a goat. Chèvre, so chèvre, chèvre. And this, we have the word bébé, and bébé, so this is more close, it is bébé. Close your mouth a bit more. So bébé, not bébé. So that will be bébé, and in fact, it's bébé. This is chèvre. It's not chèvre. Chèvre. So this is open. This is close.
We call that accent, or the accents, okay? So we call that accent aigu, accent grave, so it's an acute and I would say low accent. And this is accent circumflex. And that doesn't alter all the time the pronunciation of the letter. Most of the time it's the same as this one. Sometimes, I don't know for some others as well, I don't know if you realize that, but most of the time when we have an accent circumflex here, it's because in Old French, there used to be an S. If you look at this word, forêt, une forêt, in English it's a forest, and forest, it used to be an S here. So when you have an accent here, most of the time we used to have an S, okay? Sometimes we remove them in French, but they used to be an accent. If I say une île, that's an isle in English, yeah? If we have a maître, that used to be a master, okay? Pat, pasta, a lot of things like that. So these accents, most of the time, they are here. They are reminiscent of an old S that has been removed, and instead we put an accent. So it doesn't all the time alter the pronunciation, but when it does, it's roughly like this one. Okay. And all the other alphabet which have lines on top of it. And then, as you're saying, lines, then we have OU. And OU, there's no differences between those pronunciations. Okay, it's just OU and OU. This one means where, and this one means or. Okay, so that's why we put an accent to differentiate them. So we call that accent diacritique. So it's an accent that discriminates between, that helps you to discriminate between two words. We have the same with du and du. So this one is de plus le, and this one is the past participle of the verb devoir. So that helps you to differentiate grammatically. There's a difference, but the pronunciation is the same. So most of the time, when you have an accent on other words, on other letters, sorry, the pronunciation is the same. Except for A, I would say, A is like this, which is different than A with an accent. This one is the verb avoir, il a, for instance, he has, and this one is the preposition, which I would say in English most of the time means to. But, for instance, when I say part, that is closed A, so part, A, not A, not pat, but part. Oh, so this is closed, so you close if you have an accent circumflex on the A, and you close it as well if you got an accent circumflex on the O. Yeah? But I don't have a lot of example, but O, that would be as well. That's pretty much it about the accents related to Michel. Merci, de rien. So cool, okay, I see. Thank you so much. No, no problem, I hope. It's not easy to... Not easy to say. Euphemism, don't play. Some euphemisms are intended to amuse, while others use bland, inoffensive terms or think to use it to wishes to don't play. Exactly. So, like those fillers we talked about before. Yes, exactly that. Is the idea of an euphemism. Is the idea that you it's a don't play. Exactly. You say something, but in fact, what you're saying is not, it doesn't even match what happened. So that's really the idea of sedire. That's to say. Just to say that shows already. That shows, yeah. So that's the idea. Bien, bonne explication, merci. No problem. So, is there a specific term for the alphabet? Oui. Why the two letters glued? Is there a mystery reason? To be fair with you, I don't really know the history reason. This is something that I should I should watch it. I always, when people ask me, sometimes my students ask me, and I'm always thinking, okay, when I'm going home, I'm gonna check, but I haven't checked so far, and I don't really know from where that's from. The only thing I can tell you is that, for instance, the word birth, so an ox in English, an ox, okay, so, or beef, if you're talking about the meat, birth, so that's an animal, yeah, male cow, okay. These letters are pronounced same as œuf, by the way. An egg, œuf. Okay, so that's œuf, œuf.
That is pronounced E. And we call this letter E dans l'eau. So le E dans l'eau. E dans l'eau. So it's the E inside the O. So that's what we call E inside the O. E dans l'eau. E inside the O. Because the letter E is inside the O. So you don't write them like that. Some people do because they don't really care. I mean, but technically you're supposed to write it like that. So you're supposed to write the E inside the O. And if you look at it, for instance, in Word, when you're writing French in words using computer, then it will automatically glue those letters. So for instance, same as cœur, for instance, the heart, you will glue it pop, automatically. So when you type, you type B-O-E-U-F, and you will like automatically glue them. Exactly. That's exactly what people. That's it. That's the capital letter. So you can see that there are two letters glued in one. So if you had to write F with a capital letter, then you're supposed to write it like that. And the computer does it for yourself. Now, where is it from? I have no idea. To be fair with you, once again, that's something I should know, because that would be interesting. I have no clue what. I'm thinking, hold on. If you look at Latin, let me think about Latin for 2 seconds. Because here what I could see is like œuf will be ovo in Latin. So there's a V involved somewhere, ovo. And bœuf was bov, like bovino, bovin in French. So there's a V somewhere. So I'm thinking, is it not related to the V letter that disappeared and we kind of glued in the same idea of this capital, this had the accent that was an old S. So I'm thinking, but in the word cœur, the heart, Latin will be cuore, such as Italian, cuore, and there's no V involved here. I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know. I need to check. If someone can check, or later on I will check and I will give you the answer. At the moment I have no clue. I don't really know where that's from. The only thing I know is that exists and you have to write it like that and it's pronounced E. But apart from that, I don't know. It's the same for this word, huh, by the way. Oeil. An oeil. An eye. An oeil. And you see there's no V here involved anyway. No. It will be all cure. So I don't know. I have no idea. Okay, guys, I'm gonna finish not now, but I would say a quarter to. So at 45, I have to go because I'm cycling. I bought a bike and I'm cycling. Je fais du vélo à Londres. Et le problème est que mon trajet, so my journey, mon trajet, est maintenant plus long. Okay, so my journey is now longer than it used to be. So. Parce que je dois être à 5 heures en ville. Je dois partir maintenant de chez moi, d'ici, à 3h45 à peu près. So, je dois raccourcir, I have to shorten, je dois raccourcir le live un petit peu. So, 45-50. Ok. Merci beaucoup. Pas de problème, Soko. Plaisir. Yeah, I'm glad because I see new people as well on the chat. Soko, it's pretty much the first time, if not the second time, maybe. Chandan, I've never seen you as well, so a big welcome to all these new people. El Sabe as well. El Sabe, I'm not sure, I think you came already. Denzel for sure as well. El Sabe, I've got the idea. Yeah, you came already now, I remember. Mai as well, I'm not sure, maybe. Anyway. For the old guys, welcome back. For the new guys, welcome. Bienvenue. You get the idea of this life. It's roughly every Thursday. You ask me whatever you want, and I will try to answer your questions. We're having videos roughly on Monday, so I haven't posted anything this Monday because I couldn't. But most of every Monday you will have videos about anything, I would say, related to the French language. And then on Thursday we're having a live session, and on Sunday from 3:30 to 4:30, yes, 3:30, 4:30 London time, we're having a Skype lesson. So you just pay £5 as a fee, and then we can have a Skype lesson up to 5 people. Everything is explained on my website called easytolearnfrench.com, and then you can book online for these Skype lessons as well, for on Sunday. Some people ask me for other days. At the moment I can't because I'm teaching, and I'm busy every day, so I can't do this. Again, a big yeah, Elzabé, I remember you now. Je sais que tu n'es pas, que tu étais déjà là la dernière fois. Maintenant, je me souviens. What I was saying, yeah, a big thank you for all of you who've supported this channel so far, and you know, through the donation. We have a Patreon page as well, so everything is on my YouTube channel. If you look at the banner on the YouTube channel where you have videos and stuff, on the top right corner, you can see the links. If you want to support this channel, even a small bit helps me a lot, as the more money I'll make through this channel, the more time I can dedicate to this channel. The problem is, like, I can't do as I'd like to do on this channel because I have another job on the side. As you can imagine, I need to pay my bills as well. So the more I receive through this channel, little by little, year after year, the more I'll have time to dedicate towards this channel, and eventually, hopefully one day, why not, let's dream, I will do only this. And then we can have lives every day, we can have videos every day, we can have anything we want every day. But at the moment, I can't. So a small donation is obviously appreciated. And as I said, I've got a Patreon page as well, so you can check my Patreon page. Everything is on the link, as I explained, and you can understand the rewards and stuff like that if you're interested in this. Okay, anything else, any questions or anything that you wanted me to talk about? Could be anything really, about France, about French, about n'importe quoi, anything. Really, feel free to ask me anything. Quel est votre votre pays? I'm gonna hold on. Maybe the light is a bit better because now there's not a lot of sun. It's London. It's a bit cloudy as every day, so hopefully it's a bit okay. What is your where are you from? Quel est votre pays? Okay, quel est votre pays? Où est-ce que vous habitez? Et d'où est-ce que vous venez? Ok, so moi j'habite à Londres. Ok, et je viens de France. Ouais, j'habite à Londres et je viens de France. So tell me where you're from and where you live. Silly question. There's no silly questions here. No silly questions. Always questions, never silly. Doesn't le petit chien sounds a lot like la pétition? Le petit chien, la pétition. Yeah, I can see where le petit chien, la pétition. The thing is, like, pétition, we pronounce it sion, not petition. So that would be in an English point of view, or at least an English pronunciation point of view, then we'll have a sh at the end. So every word finishing with T-I-O-N-S in English are pronounced sh, like nation, petition. So with a sh sound, in French, sion, with a s sound, sion, petition, nation, election, yeah, the election. So for us, less, because le petit chien is the sh sound and it's un after, and then we have petition, which is a C, S sound, and is instead of un. So I understand, but yes and no, because in the French point of view, it's more like there's nothing more different than it is with the more English pronunciation. I've been in France for 9 months for study abroad. Very good. Is there anything specific I should do besides the obvious touristy stuff? Yeah, try frog legs. That'll be a good thing for you. No, I don't know anything specific. I don't know. It depends where you go. Are you going to Paris or are you going somewhere else? And I'll tell you. Hammersmith, et vous? Ah, Hammersmith. Moi, j'habite à côté de Stratford. So, Londres aussi, ouais. merci. Je viens de Londres. Bien. Je viens de Londres. Be careful. Je viens aux Anassia. Forget this. So, Abby, where will you go in France? Où est-ce que vous allez en France? À Paris ou en province? Strasbourg, but I'm planning to travel. Ok, Strasbourg, yeah, Strasbourg. It's a nice city, I heard. Strasbourg. If you're planning to travel, it depends on how far you can travel, but of course, you have to go to Paris, as it is the capital and there's quite a lot of things to see. But not only, I mean, Lyon is a nice place as well. We have the castle in the Loire Valley, which is a bit more west of Paris. Beautiful as well. Then there's the south, of course, southeast. That's where I'm from, which is a very nice region as well. Yeah, there's Nice. There is places like that which are very nice in southeast France. So yeah, apart from that, well, I don't really know. No, there's nothing really, anything that you can try. I would say, and you know, you're aware of that. Try not to stay too much with foreigners. Try to stay with the French people. And one good way to meet people, I would say, in France is to do a sport or any activities. We have a lot of what we call associations, which are like associations, group. So either sports or any kind of activities, whatever. Then people meet and you know, we do an activity together. There's a lot of that in France. There's a lot of, you know, like benevolence. Type of activities. So this is a good way you can meet French people. Otherwise it becomes a bit hard, especially when you're a foreigner, then you live with foreigners and then you just end up talking to foreigners. But if you want to meet French, I would give you as an advice to try to do as much sports, whatever the sport it is, but that will help you to meet native people. And as well, as I said, some associations and stuff which are great to which are great to you know, great for meeting people. That would be my advice, really, really. And don't be afraid. Can tout use as adverb? Can you give some example? So tout can be used as noun, pronoun. There's a little bit confusing. No, tout can't be used as a noun. Tout, it's either a pronoun. Can be used as noun. Yes, yes and no. Ah, why is it so complicated? Okay, to make it simple, to, it's either an adjective, as I said, tout le monde, that qualifies the word le monde, which means the world, so all the world, okay? Toute la journée, that qualifies the word la journée, which means the day, so toute la journée will means all the day, so that qualifies the word la journée. But if I'm saying tout, as I said before, tout est arrivé. Everything has arrived. Here it's a pronoun because, in fact, it can be a pronoun sujet, as in my example. Tout est arrivé. Everything has arrived. In this meaning, in this example, tout is a pronoun. Okay, tous, when you do pronounce the S, it's a pronoun as well. So that means all of them. Okay, so all of them came, tous sont venus. Okay. So that's the main difference between between most of the time you use it either as an adjective or we have a pronoun. Marseille. Ah, Marseille. J'habite en Floride. Ah, Floride, Phil. Ok, merci. J'habite en Afrique du Sud. Ah, Denzil, l'Afrique du Sud. Interesting. C'est Afrique du Sud, Londres, Marseille, Floride. Intéressant. Okay. So any more questions, guys? Anything
that you wanted to ask me? Play a game? Yeah, we can play a game. Combien d'années avez-vous vécu à Londres? J'habite à Londres depuis 9 ans, depuis 2008. Depuis 2008, donc 9 ans. 9 ans. Juin 2008. So, bientôt 9 ans. Bientôt 9 ans. Le mois prochain. 9 ans. Donc ça fera 9 ans dans un mois. Ouais. I'm just cooking pasta but I'm listening. Okay. Ça va. Bon appétit. I like pasta. Yeah, moi aussi, j'aime les pâtes. Play a game. What game could we play? What game could we play? Any idea, Denzel, what game you want to play? Because I don't really know now. Not really inspired. What could we do? I Spy? I Spy? Intéressant. J'ai une question. Une question pour vous. Quelle est pour vous la personnalité française la plus célèbre? Ok, la plus célèbre, la plus populaire. Le français ou la française la plus populaire, la plus célèbre. Hein? What is the most famous French person that you know? So what is the most famous French person that you know? Piaf, yeah. So Edith Piaf, that's what I guessed. So I guessed already beforehand, before asking you this question, I guessed what your answer would be. Piaf was in there. She was like in the top 5. Probably Edith too, yeah. So Edith Piaf as well. Others? What do you know? What French people do you know? If I'm talking about a French person, what do you see in your mind straight away? Marine Le Pen? Oh, gosh. Okay, fair enough. Renault, ouais. Jean Renault. Jean Reno, so an actor, yeah, Jean Reno played in Léon, the movie Léon, le film Léon. De Gaulle, ouais, De Gaulle. So who was a politician, who as well was a military officer, who worked for the French resistance during the Second World War and became after the French president. Marie Antoinette, ouais. So Marie Antoinette was the wife of Louis XVI, who got killed during the French Revolution, and she was killed as well. She got killed as well. She was an Austrian lady. She was from Austria, and then she got executed during the French Revolution, being the wife of Louis the 16th. Louis says. Okay, interesting. Marie Antoinette, I would not have guessed that. But you haven't said the first one, in my opinion. But she's by far one of the most famous French person in the whole world. No? Others? Like Napoleon? That for me is, I would say, the most famous French guy, Napoleon. Edith Piaf, yeah. Marie Tautou, ouais, Marie Tautou, ouais. Marie Tautou, is the other way around, Tautou. Marie Tautou, who played in Amélie. Le fabuleux destin d'Amélie Poulain. Yeah. Marie Tautou. Is it Marie? Marie Tautou? Audrey Tautou, yeah, that's true. It's Audrey Tautou. Yeah. Zaz, yeah, more famous than Gérard Depardieu. Yeah, Gérard Depardieu, that's it. It's very famous as well. That's what we guessed as well. Gérard Depardieu. Adré. Audrey, yeah, Audrey. Audrey Tautou, yeah. Bonjour, je suis en retard. Ah, Vincent, we're gonna finish. On va bientôt arrêter, Vincent. It's a shame that you just arrived because we're gonna finish very soon, in fact. I'm afraid next week. Marie Antoinette, yeah. What are they? So, Napoléon. Depardieu. We said. Marie Antoinette, yeah. Louis XIV. Louis the 14th. The Sun King, as we call him, Versailles, and all this, so the King of Versailles and things, pretty famous as well. Monet, ouais, Monet, the painter, Monet, that's true. Monet, any writers? I'm sure you know at least one or two writers. Je sais la chanson de Robert Charlebois, je pense qu'il est célèbre. Ouais, la chanson de Robert Charlebois, mais Robert Charlebois, il est canadien. Il est canadien, il est québécois. Il n'est pas français, il est québécois. Bah, ça marche aussi, mais il est québécois. Most famous Brit to you. Most famous Brit to you, to me, the Queen, I guess. Otherwise, you are. It's David Beckham, I would say. Like the most famous Brit person in the world. Beckham and, you know, David Beckham and Victoria Beckham would be the most, in a bit more classic. As I said, the Queen, but the more classic, maybe writers like Orwell and I would say Orwell for the writers, maybe, or Oscar Wilde. These are the famous writers, I would say, or Tolkien, who wrote the Lord of the Ring as well. It's pretty famous abroad. Lewis Carroll for Alice in Wonderland, but I'm not sure people know him. I know they know the book, but maybe not necessarily him. It's like Kipling for the Jungle Book as well. Molière, that's good. Shakespeare, well, yeah, Shakespeare. that's pretty famous as well. Yeah, Shakespeare, that's true. In fact, Shakespeare is most famous. Writer, that's correct. It's so famous that I kind of forgot. Molière, it's Molière. Talking about Molière and Shakespeare, and just I finish here, guys. Les Misérables, it's Hugo, it's Victor Hugo, it's not Molière, it's Victor Hugo, Les Misérables. Montaigne, yeah, that's very good. Montaigne, Jeanne d'Arc, yeah, guys, you know a lot, that's cool. I forgot, I read his essay, yeah, his essay de Montaigne, very famous book, very good book, actually, a very, very nice book. So, talking about something about writers in French, we have an expression. If we are talking about a certain language,
then instead of saying the name of the language, so for instance, instead of saying English, English language, we would say the language of, and I give the famous writer. So when I talk about English, I'm saying the language of Shakespeare.
So I would say la langue, which means the tongue, so the language, la langue de Shakespeare. That means English. Okay. French is la langue de Molière. So if you're saying la langue de Molière, or la langue de Victor Hugo as well, la langue de Hugo, la langue de Molière. The more famous la langue de Molière. We're talking about French. If you're saying Italian, l'italien, c'est la langue de Dante. L'espagnol, c'est la langue de Cervantes. Allemand, German, c'est la langue de Goethe. Japanese, le japonais, c'est la langue de Mishima. Russe, c'est la langue de Tolstoy, je crois. I think it's Tolstoy. For us, is the name we give. So we have this expression here for languages. We're saying the language of, and then we give for us what is the famous writer of that nation, I would say. So it's pretty, if you see that sometimes written in a text or whatever, just understand it that in fact it's just another way, a more poetic way to say the language. So instead of saying Italian, I can say the language of Dante. Guy de Maupassant, very good as well. I forgot to say, good idea to switch iPhone to French for vocab. Yes, it's a very good idea to switch iPhone to French. It's the same if, I don't know if you're playing a lot of video games or not, guys, but for those of you playing video games, I strongly advise you, if your level is kind of acceptable, to switch it to French. And that's how I learned my English, really, to be fair. I'm playing video games, switch to English, and then it's hard at the beginning, but then you start to get some words here and there. You got your dictionary next to you, and that's a good way to learn useful vocab. But it was in English. Yeah, Denzel, I did that, and it was really good. Also helped me a lot with directions. Yes, very good. Thank Abby. Suskin. I think it's easier to use English to learn French. Yeah. But it depends if the level is good. Yeah. Okay, guys, I'm afraid I have to go, otherwise I'm gonna be late. So, merci à tous et à toutes. La semaine prochaine, jeudi prochain, live à partir de 2h jusqu'à 3h50, comme aujourd'hui. Merci. Thanks for the support. Thanks for people, you know, donates and things like that. It's always appreciated. See you next time. Feel free to have your questions ready for next time. And we'll see each other next Thursday, jeudi prochain. Okay? Merci. Au revoir.